Good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's event, Big Decisions 2022. I'm Richard Newell. I'm the President and CEO at Resources for the Future, or RFF. Thanks for joining us. For those of you who aren't familiar with RFF, we're an independent nonprofit research institution based in Washington, D.C., and our mission is to improve environmental, energy, and natural resource decisions through impartial economic research and policy engagement. I'm pleased to share that 2022 marks 70 years since RFF's founding. So what better way to commemorate seven decades of finding paths to a healthy environment and economy than to forecast some of the most important issues we're tracking for this next year. So today we'll be anticipating some of the biggest decisions in climate, energy, and the environment for the year ahead. We'll be exploring which issues are likely to dominate headlines and where we might see major policy advancements, from next steps in the implementation of the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act to the role of the courts in influencing the US regulatory agenda. So we'll kick things off with four quickfire rounds of discussion with our panel before moving to audience Q&A. And to support a very well-informed conversation around these issues, I'm pleased to be joined today by four distinguished experts in their field. First, Juliet Eilperin is a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist and deputy editor overseeing coverage of climate and the environment at the Washington Post. Carlos Martín is the David M. Rubenstein Fellow at Brookings and has led research and policy analysis for federal, state, and non-governmental institutions in fields including energy efficiency, climate mitigation and adaptation, and energy and environmental justice for more than 20 years. We're also joined this morning by Mary Nichols, who's distinguished counsel at the UCLA School of Law and the Emmett Institute on Climate Change and the Environment. Mary's the former chair of the California Air Resources Board, where she served under three governors. Finally, we're really pleased to be joined by Richard Revesz, who's the Anne Bryce Professor of Law and Dean Emeritus of the New York University School of Law. Ricky's also the founder and director of the Institute for Policy Integrity. So Juliet, Carlos, Mary, and Ricky, welcome to today's panel. We're really glad to have you here.
Thank you.
So a few housekeeping notes before we get started. This is a public webinar. It's being recorded and it will be posted on our website afterward. As time allows, we'll open it up for the webinar to audience Q&A at the end of the session. And we'd encourage you to submit your questions at any point into the Q&A box, which is located at the bottom of your screen. We'll be monitoring those questions and we'll get to as many as we possibly can. Also, if you'd like to join the conversation on Twitter, please use the hashtag RFFLive. So with that, let's get started. We're going to talk first about the Bipartisan Infrastructure Act and the Build Back Better legislation. And Juliet, I'll turn to you first. You've been working at the Post since 1998. You've previously served as senior national affairs correspondent, White House bureau chief, national environment reporter, and correspondent for the House of Representatives. So in many ways, now including your new capacity as deputy editor for climate and the environment, you're really uniquely in touch with the big decisions happening here in Washington, D.C. So how are you approaching the Post's coverage of implementation of the now passed Infrastructure Act, as well as the ongoing efforts to find a path forward for the Build Back Better legislation? You know, what are you tracking most closely, and what do you see as the most significant potential developments to come on these two fronts?
Well, thanks for the question. I would say that, you know, we are looking right now at obviously what the, you know, hundreds of billions of dollars that that, for example, the bipartisan infrastructure package has devoted towards climate and the environment, how that's going to be distributed across the country. And, you know, we're in really early days when it comes to that, as you can imagine, since it obviously takes time to get out this money, especially when it's slightly different from, say, a stimulus bill, where you're just getting checks out the door. And what we're obviously seeing right now is that the federal government is staffing up and beginning to assess, you know, how it can distribute these funds. But, you know, clearly we, you know, described that bill as the most significant climate bill in US history to pass. And we expect to see a huge amount of, you know, a huge amount of money going to bolster, for example, a transition to clean energy. We've seen it already in terms of the government looking at how it can fund electric vehicle charging stations and what that will mean. We had a story last month about how there were Superfund sites across the country that are stalled, and roughly 40 of them will now get money that, you know, had just eventually been, you know, sitting around continuing to implement pollution. So, you know, there's a huge range of ways in which this will transform Americans' lives. And I think one of the roles of the Washington Post and other media outlets is to really scrutinize that funding in the same way, for example, we did with the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act under President Obama, where you really look at some of these things, and these numbers are extremely abstract, but on the ground, they can, you know, trigger real shifts, both in terms of, you know, communities and their development, as well as obviously kind of broader industries. And then shifting, of course, to Build Back Better, the obviously fraught and troubled bill that that essentially President Biden and Democrats in the Senate have been struggling to pass over the objections of Joe Manchin. It's a fascinating process to watch, and it's important. We've been trying to track in real time all the potential changes and what can happen there. And so I think it's just incumbent on us to really give a sense of, you know, in an evolving situation, what are the prospects for this bill? And also, of course, when it's in trouble, what is it that the administration can do through executive action to spur some of the shifts, but at the same time, making it clear that there is no substitute for, you know, a law. We've seen that these laws can have such enduring effects and impacts compared to, say, the executive action by a president who's often replaced by someone of a different party.
Yeah, thanks, Juliet. So just to drill a bit deeper on this, so, you know, the $1 trillion infrastructure package was signed into law just before Thanksgiving. And so in addition to providing funding for, you know, traditional infrastructure spending, such as, you know, roads and bridges, it also provided funding for states in several areas that, you know, would be key enablers of emission reductions, like EV charging infrastructure, public transit, clean energy technology innovation, and the electric grid. And this question is also for any others who'd like to jump in. You know, what do you see as the most significant components of the infrastructure package, in particular with respect to emission reduction in the near term and longer term? And are there key decisions in implementing the legislation, you know, that perhaps that Juliet hasn't already brought up that you see lying ahead? Any others want to jump in on that? Ricky?
Yeah, one thing that excites me and I think is a very beneficial move for the federal government to have undertaken is are the provisions dealing with the siting of electric transmission lines. We've had a fairly dysfunctional system in this country where it's very easy to locate gas pipelines and very hard to locate electricity transmission lines. And in the current energy environment that facilitates the, you know, the current policies have facilitated the use of fossil fuels and have discouraged the use of renewables, because renewables are often produced far away from dense areas where they would be consumed. And being able to get transmission lines from places where renewables are produced in large volume to where they would be consumed is a real challenge. The infrastructure legislation doesn't do a huge amount in this area, but it has some beneficial provisions that, at least in principle, could facilitate the siting of transmission lines. The extent to which that actually happens, you know, we have to see. The devil will be in the details, but there are good measures there which give new powers to both DOE and FERC to help move transition projects forward and potentially overcome siting barriers. There are more ambitious bills floating around Congress. Those haven't passed. So this is not like the, I think, the be all and end all of this problem. And I don't think it's going to like solve the problem, but it might be a beneficial step. How beneficial? We'll have to see in the implementation.
Carlos, go ahead.
Just a comment around the implementation issues, which are going to be the real challenges here. It's important to note, I mean, I'm very grateful for Richard pointing out the new pieces of quote unquote infrastructure, however we define it. But it's also important to note that most of the infrastructure still is very traditionally funded, and much of it is traditional formula grants going to states. And so the projects that states pick, particularly in sort of traditional infrastructure world, are going to be the real challenge. And that's what we're going to be tracking over the next year. We've already seen some states, Texas Governor Abbott saying, sending a letter to agencies saying, well, be hesitant about taking any of the IIJA funds in case it implicates the state in any kind of policy that we do not agree with. And so there is a real challenge in that lever that we're going to need to be tracking.
Yeah. This money is not going to go out to anything innovative quickly. And it's not going to do anything beneficial for climate without ferocious advocacy and involvement on the part of people who care about climate change. Because the only money that actually flows without much additional action, and it all requires some congressional action just to appropriate the money for existing programs. But for anything that's new and different, there's going to be more negotiation and more tough arguments to be made. And then you flow it to the state level in most cases, where so few people understand state budgeting processes and how money actually gets into the hands of even cities, much less community organizations and the kinds of entities that are actually going to build or permit the projects that are going to actually reduce the emissions. So, you know, I understand that if you're focused on Washington and in the international realm as well, passing a big bill, trillion-dollar bills is $1 trillion. That's definitely, definitely big, lots of money. But by the time you've spent the next 3 years allocating it all out there and tracking where the money goes, this is not even as easy as the Obama era rebuilding effort, because we're not just going back taking easy things that need to be done. You know, figuring out where the electric charging station should go, just as an example, is not easy, and it's not free of controversy. And when there isn't enough money there, or where you've got hostility on the part of some entities, it's going to be even harder. So I don't want to I don't want to discourage Congress from acting at all. But I obviously would like to commend the president for having put big money out there, because that's the first sign of actual accomplishment on the part of Congress, period, which is important to our standing in the rest of the world. But I really want to caution us that this is the beginning of a tough implementation process, not the end.
Yeah, thanks for those thoughts. And Mary, I don't know if you have any further quick thoughts on the role of federal state coordination or any type of federal guidelines in making infrastructure planning and spending decisions, especially which you've already alluded to. You've got the additional intention of not just building infrastructure, but having those investments lay the groundwork for decarbonization. So is there?
Yeah, well, the policy is can be articulated by the president, but then to really make sure that he follows through, that the agencies and the recipients of the funds follow through requires a lot more in the way of accountability detail. And I know there are people hard at work at that in several of the agencies trying to figure out how to make that happen. But, there are key actions going on right now. And we were talking about, 2020 big decisions. EPA is engaged in some major rulemakings around standards for trucks, for example, for heavy duty vehicles, as well as for a further round of work on light duty passenger cars. And, if we take our eye off that particular ball, that will weaken every other link in this chain going forward. So I think it's, talking about all of government approach to this thing, it really does take an all of government approach.
Yeah. We'll come back in some more detail to EPA regulation in a little bit. Let's turn briefly though to next steps on Build Back Better legislation. And this is also a question for anyone who wants to weigh in. Build Back Better, of course, contains over $500 billion worth of investments to address climate change. Targets additional clean electricity and electric vehicles, among other things. It's pretty clear based on analysis that the tax incentives for clean electric power contained in legislation have the biggest climate impact, and the incentives for clean transportation like electric vehicles probably have the second biggest impact. But, you know, first of all, you know, please let me know if any of you have a different sense of the likely impact of Build Back Better, but especially though whether you see other elements of Build Back Better climate provisions that you view as being particularly important for addressing climate change. We've caught them.
They're certainly the two biggest ones. And obviously that's part of why there's been such a huge debate over, you know, how generous these subsidies can be or tax credits and what are their implications. So while, you know, given that frankly, you know, Joe Manchin has effectively killed the clean electricity performance program, you know, those are the most significant aspects of the bill in terms of their overall impact.
Juliet, a quick follow-up question for you. You know, do you see continued friction around the climate provisions of Build Back Better, or are they now a point of relative common ground in these discussions and the friction is elsewhere?
Interestingly, there's still conflict over some of the electric vehicle tax credits. That is one area where Senator Manchin has objected to aspects, whether it's the requirements that they be made in America or also just the overall size of those tax credits. Beyond that, he is largely signed off on the climate provisions, and Senator Sinema, who was the other main obstacle to this getting passed, you know, has been largely supportive of these climate measures from the beginning. So at this point, really, it's things like the child care tax credit and others that are bigger obstacles to its passage.
If the overall reconciliation bill, you know, were to fall through, are there particular elements that you think will have legs in more targeted legislation?
I think we should be looking at the bills that have to pass for the next couple of years that already provide funding that states and interests are dependent on, like the farm bill, for example, and be looking at what could be done there and what ideas are coming forward already for how to put money out there that is in a bill that, as I said, is going to go no matter what.
The tax credits, however, for wind and solar, for example, if you know, those are things that again could potentially pass independently and would have huge implications. Part of the strategy that the Biden administration has had is, and you'll see this, we're going to see this any day with, for example, permitting of offshore wind in the New York Bight off of New York and New Jersey, is they want to get concrete and steel in the ground and get these projects launched. So regardless of what kind of administration follows, they can be done. So that I would certainly identify that of the existing, of the provisions that might not get finalized through Build Back Better would probably be the top priority, followed by some sort of support for electric vehicles.
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, given just the history of, tax credits for clean power, They have definitely, you know, stood the test of political time, let's say. So if not legislation, you know, what tools are available to the Biden administration to pursue climate actions at the executive branch level? And what would you expect the absence of Build Back Better, if that happened, to support or hinder those actions? We're going to come to EPA power plant regulation in a minute, but are there other areas of executive action that could substitute for what would be accomplished in Build Back Better, or particular aspects of it?
I think we should regard these as complements and not substitutes. The week one executive orders, the two executive orders that President Biden signed, one on the first day and one a week later, set forth a very ambitious program for many, many federal agencies. We already sort of, talked about an all of government approach to climate change. It's not just EPA, it's not just Interior, it's not just energy, it's not just the SEC, it's not just the Postal Service buying electric vehicles, it's not just the Fed. We could name pretty much every federal agency, and every federal agency has been asked, or almost every federal agency has been asked to do things here. And I think those things are underway and we will see them. I'm not sure there's a single policy where we would say, oh, because Build Back Better didn't pass, we will do something new, or because Build Back Better passed, we will now not do something we had planned to do. But there are complements. So for example, if Build Back Better were to pass and were to move the electricity market towards renewables, that will have to be part of the EPA analysis. So the EPA analysis of what the costs and benefits of a regulation are would have to take that as a baseline. And if it doesn't pass, then the baseline will be different and the analysis will be different. And where we end up on that standard might also look different. But though these things have to proceed alongside one another, and we should not make the mistake, which I think we actually did make early in the Obama administration, to put a lot of eggs in the Waxman-Markey basket and essentially postpone moving aggressively on the regulatory front. Because then in the end, Congress might not do its thing. And the timeline for putting regulations in place that will have gone through judicial review before the end of an administration is very short. And it's short even if a president is reelected, as Barack Obama was, if things get pushed off to the second term. So I think all of these things should be proceeding, and the final form might look somewhat different, but they are complements and not substitutes.
Go ahead, Carlos.
Just a quick addition. I mean, I think there are certain things that can be done with the with not necessarily an expanding climate and environmental energy, if Build Back Better doesn't occur, but in terms of the distributional benefits and access to them. And so certainly Justice 40, that I'm sure we'll be speaking about more later, helps incentivize some of the discretionary grant programs that come out of the Infrastructure Act. But I do want to just make a quick pass before we go to the next subject, that many of the other the social safety net, the things that are not explicitly environment, climate, and energy that are in Build Back Better, have climate, energy, and environment implications, right? Because you're dealing with households' capacity to be able to afford to access other resources. And so we can't, and of course, those are the touchiest parts of the Build Back Better bill for Sinema and Manchin, as well as the Republicans. So I feel like it's important to note that those things have environmental implications just as much. And ultimately it's the money, the resources. So we're talking about political, intellectual, and financial resources that are necessary. So without Build Back Better, it's gonna be a lot harder.
I would just also flag that I think to your question, because I know we'll deal with EPA shortly, but that the transportation department is a place where I think you could see both in terms of rulemaking as well as grants, actions that potentially could, you know, certainly will be aimed at achieving some of the goals of this legislation. How effective those executive actions are remain to be seen. But I think that's next to EPA, probably the place where you would see the most executive action trying to fill in the gap if Build Back Better doesn't pass.
And are you thinking there specifically with regard to things like fuel economy standards or other aspects?
I think beyond that, I mean, that there's certainly that, but there's fuel economy standards. Obviously, we've seen tons of action on cars and light trucks. I think heavy duty trucks are a target that, you know, again, kind of Obama didn't fully get to, and that you certainly will see more significant action. But I mean, across the board, I just think they're really minor, you know, or whatever, you know, I track, for example, on our environmental regulatory tracker, I look at every single rollback. And, you know, for example, one of the things that's on transportation's to-do list is actually notifying consumers of what tires are more energy efficient compared to others. That was a rollback under Trump, which I'm sure we will see restored under this administration. So there, and I'm sure there are, you know, more robust policies, but that's one that comes to mind. So I think what you have is you have a secretary who's extremely focused on it. You have former aides to Mary Nichols who are now working in the Obama administration who are extremely focused on it. You have action, you know, kind of a much more concerted effort than we absolutely saw in the Obama administration. And that will translate into rules over time, as well as certainly a change in how grants are allocated.
rules and enforcement as well, because there are rules on the books that have never actually been fully enforced or implemented that sometimes people just aren't aware of. Sometimes they're actually ignoring them, like being in compliance with standards in order to get a contract to pave a road or to repair a bridge. Are you bringing out heavy construction equipment that meets standards or doesn't meet standards? Those kinds of things. Can make an enormous difference in actual emissions on the ground.
So, let's, we've already started doing it, but let's turn now to environmental regulation by the US EPA, and in particular, the role of the courts. So Ricky, as one of the leading voices in environmental and regulatory law and policy, you know, you keep a close eye, of course, on the evolving role of the courts in US environmental regulation. So to set the context here, you know, how have you seen this role changing and how does that condition the situation as we look to decisions in 22 and beyond? You know, I'll come to a moment specifically about West Virginia versus EPA, but is there any scene setting for where we find ourselves right now that's helpful to keep in mind?
Well, it's actually a little hard to address this issue without mentioning West Virginia versus EPA because it is the elephant in the room right now. And the doctrinal elephant in the room is this thing that almost no one talked about a decade ago. It just wasn't like something that people worried about a lot, called the major questions doctrine. It was spun out of whole cloth essentially over the last decade. It had been used before in a handful of cases that actually did present quite exceptional circumstances. Sometimes agencies that really, to which Congress had not empowered a particular issue, taking very aggressive action on this issue. Now it's being used promiscuously. Basically, almost every environmental regulation, the challenger to the regulation says, oh, you know, this is a major questions doctrine issue. The doctrine has no bounds. The Supreme Court has never set bounds. And, you know, the fact that challengers raise it isn't on its own that worrisome. But what is worrisome is that the courts have expressed great interest in it. Most recently on Friday, in connection with the oral argument of the OSHA masking, testing, and vaccine mandate case, a majority of the justices were all over this issue. And, you know, often this doctrine is, you know, the arguments that are made are, well, there were like millions of comments. You know, often these millions of comments are like a manufacturer or produced by bots or produced in Russia or are just kind of like add-on comments that groups kind of paid to get done. Or the fact that this is a controversial issue in our society. We are such a divided country now that virtually every issue is controversial. And it may very well have been statutes that were not controversial when they were passed, including the Clean Air Act, where EPA did all kinds of things that had bipartisan support, but now they're controversial. So does that mean that every EPA action might raise these questions? Looks at the costs, the number of beneficiaries. Look, you would actually hope that many environmental regulations would benefit practically everyone. I mean, the fact that they benefit everyone, does that make it a major questions issue? And then what's the meaning of making it a major questions issue? It was initially thought to deprive the agency of Chevron deference, of the deference that an agency gets as the body to which Congress has delegated the interpretation of the statute. But now it may be in the process of being transformed into something that deprives the agency of the power to do things. I was talking to a reporter yesterday who said, well, at least, you know, the major questions doctrine is less harmful than non-delegation doctrine because agencies could still do things that don't give rise to this sort of major question. And my answer was, well, you know, we don't know what the bounds are. And frankly, agencies shouldn't be doing things that are unimportant. And if they can't do anything that's important because it raises this issue, then, you know, we're really in a bad place. You know, having said that, we don't know where the court will land on this. It's a huge concern. But if we have time later, I kind of would like to explain that it's not a concern across the board. I mean, it arises, it's more likely to stand in the way of certain regulations than others. And, you know, certain, you know, including certain environmental regulations than others and certain regulations that have significant greenhouse gas benefits than others. So while it's a very dangerous development and one that could have enormous impacts, it's not necessarily an across-the-board issue. And we can, if there's time, we can maybe explore that later.
Yeah, and so so that's great. We're diving right in, and so the one of the key things that for context is this issue of the major questions doctrine. And Ricky, you dove right in on that. I think people probably got a good sense of what it is, but can you briefly describe like what is that notion?
Well, the stated rule is that if a regulation has vast economic and political significance, then either an agency doesn't get deference in interpreting the statute, or the agency doesn't have the authority to actually do the regulation in the first place. These two things are extremely different. You know, I think initially the major questions doctrine was thought of as implicating the first, but now it could well implicate the second. And certainly the argument on Friday, the challengers and, you know, we're making the very strong point that the agency just didn't have the authority to do this. And the briefs in the West Virginia case, both the party briefs and the amicus briefs, have this argument all over them. So it may be that, you know, on a very amorphous standard or whatever, you know, this vast economic and political significance means, which has all these different like sub criteria of comments and salience and costs and this and that, that an agency might be deprived of the power to regulate. Look, obviously Congress in the vaccine testing and mandate case did not say we're authorizing OSHA to have a vaccine testing and mandate regulation involving COVID, because Congress didn't, you know, COVID wasn't a thing when the OSHA Act was passed. But Congress, you know, did contemplate immunizations because there is a religious exemption requirement for any immunization regulation that might take place. So it clearly contemplated immunizations, and it contemplated the agency acting in emergencies and so on. So, you know, it's pretty specific. Obviously did not address, you know, COVID and what might happen in 2021 or 2022, but that's the way the whole regulatory state has been built. So we'll have to see where the court lands on that question. We'll have to see where the court lands on West Virginia versus EPA. We'll know by June. And we may be in a different place by then than we have been in the past, or maybe this will be a flash in the pan and we won't worry about it that much anymore. Who knows?
We've alluded a couple times already to the West Virginia versus EPA case. So that's scheduled for argument before the Supreme Court on February 28th. As Rick has already said, there's, I guess, playing out in the context of COVID and vaccination policy, we may get a preview on some aspects of that. It sounds like you're saying, Ricky, which could be quite interesting. Maybe if we have time, we'll come back to that. So to anybody, in addition to Ricky, that wants to weigh in, you know, so let's dig a little bit deeper. So what's at stake here? And we've already heard that one thing that's at stake is like, what are the bounds on EPA's regulatory authority? But if we could, you know, maybe drill in a little bit more about what the ramifications might be for Clean Air Act regulation, or what might the ramifications be for social regulation more generally? And I guess we're also, again, seeing this play out in other contexts. You know, Ricky, I'm sure you have further views on that. Mary, you know, in 1972, you know, you filed one of the very first lawsuits under the Clean Air Act, and so which lies at the heart of this case. You may have views as well. But Ricky, do you want to dive a little bit deeper into what some of the implications might be of this of the decision on the West Virginia versus EPA?
Well, I think the things that are going to be at most risk are things that look to the court as new approaches. The Clean Power Plan has been portrayed by its opponents as a new type of regulatory approach because of blocks 2 and 3. Block 2, as I think probably everyone knows, is a shift from coal to gas, and block 3 is a shift from coal and gas to renewables. And I think EPA has very strong statutory arguments for doing that. It's been portrayed as a new thing. Actually, you know, the Policy Integrity Institute that I run has put out a report a long time ago showing that EPA in the past, under administrations of both parties, has used similar regulatory approaches. So this kind of like new thing idea is actually incorrect. But the court has been especially hostile to an agency finding new authorities in statutes that are, you know, have been around for decades. I think unfairly, the Clean Power Plan has been portrayed this way. It's much harder to portray other environmental regulations this way. So for example, I think the car standards, the vehicle emission standards, and the EPA vehicle emission standards and the DOT CAFE standards are on much stronger footing. They've been around for a long time. Basically, the agency is using regular techniques that it has used for decades. And the court has held that greenhouse gases are air pollutants for the purpose of the Clean Air Act. And Massachusetts EPA, it was done explicitly in the kind of transportation context and in connection with EPA authority to set standards for mobile sources. So that's why I don't think that the major questions doctrine would endanger all greenhouse gas regulation in the same way. I think the regulation of the power sector is most at issue because it actually makes sense to have a flexible approach in the way that the Clean Air Act, that the Clean Power Plan put in place, as opposed to telling every fossil fuel plant, you know, install this like really expensive gizmo, and this is what you have to do, which I think would not raise a major questions issue, yeah. But would be a not effective and very expensive way to regulate. Then there are other regulations that are not explicitly greenhouse gas regulations that have significant greenhouse gas benefits. For example, the cross-state air pollution rule, under the Clean Air Act, the effluent limit guidelines under the Clean Water Act, those have, you know, have strong legal pedigree. I mean, the Supreme Court itself has upheld the cross-state air pollution rule. And so new generations adapting it to the current levels of non-attainment would be on strong footing. So it's, one would have to do sort of a case-by-case analysis, regulation by regulation, for determining which things are at most major questions risk. But basically anything that looks like an innovative approach on a statute that's been around for decades is going to be at kind of most risk.
So you've already mentioned some of the other regulatory areas kind of in conventional air and water regulation, like, you know, ozone standard and mercury rule, water use at thermal plants. You know, do others want to jump in on how important one thing I hear you saying is we should expect regulatory activity on those fronts. And how consequential would those be for greenhouse gas emission reductions? Is it big implications, or is, you know, the water use at thermal plants going to mainly affect water?
Oh, big implications. I mean, for example, I mean, there are a lot of EPA proceedings underway, for example, whether EPA strengthens the National Ambient Quality Standards for particulates and ozone, which would then give rise to all these other things. And the cross-state air pollution rules would have to get strengthened because there'd be more non-attainment areas. All those things have enormous implications because there's a strong correlation in the power sector between, and again, the power sector is the area where the major questions doctrine raises the most issues. And there's a huge correlation in the power sector between the emission of particulate matter and the emission of greenhouse gases. So we should think of this whole package as being together. And basically, we should think of the greenhouse gas regulations of the power sector as having significant local health benefits because of the reduction of particulate matter. And we should think of the particulate matter regulations having significant greenhouse gas benefits. These things go together, and we should think of the whole constellation and look at, you know, and if the court expands the major questions doctrine in ways that put some environmental regulations at risk, we should look at the whole panoply of EPA regulatory authorities to see where one can move the needle the most at least legal risk. I mean, and some of this analysis is going on already, but it will become even more necessary, depending on where the court moves doctrinally over the net between now and the end of June.
Yeah. Just to follow up on that, I would say that, you know, as Ricky's mentioning, I mean, that's basically, particularly the fine particle pollution is one of the biggest levers that EPA has to essentially make it more expensive to operate coal-fired power plants. And, you know, I always say that when I'm either talking to people outside the post or when I'm trying to guide reporters, I always say, you know, the biggest step that Barack Obama took to shut down coal plants in this country was the mercury and air toxics rule. It was not, you know, it was not the Clean Power Plan, which never took effect. But in fact, you know, the rule that was enacted towards the end of his first term, which simply made it much more expensive for coal-fired power plants to emit traditional pollutants, including neurotoxins, was the single largest driver, along with a concerted, you know, litigation strategy by environmental groups that shut down coal-fired power plants across the country. And so what you would see, and certainly in the works now, are further rules that could essentially just make the cost of doing business when it comes to burning coal more expensive in an effort to try to shut down.
Yeah, looking for again in the coming year. And I think you need to look at EPA and the horrible loss of expertise and just bodies that they have suffered in the last few years, and what's being done to help build back their capacity to do the kinds of regulations that will have those kinds of long-term impacts. EPA is not the agency that it was even, you know, 5 years ago. And although there's efforts underway and obviously a sense of hope and some momentum, one of the things that they need to do and are not especially accustomed to doing is to partner with other entities that can help them do some of these rulemakings and get them done faster, because you know, it just takes a lot of time to grind out regulations under federal administrative procedure laws, and the science is not all where it needs to be. They don't have the level of consultants that they've had in the past. And so again, down in the weeds here where things get implemented, it's really important to pay attention to getting them the kind of support that they need to have.
Yeah, that's an important point. That point has shown up at least twice now, one in the context of the EPA regulation. Mary, you also mentioned it earlier in the context of, you know, money, getting money out the door and putting in place the, you know, the different requirements and procedures and programs to do that. So I want to shift the gears slightly to focus in on the new forthcoming estimates of the social cost of carbon and other greenhouse gases, another big decision that should be coming soon. As many of you know, the social cost of carbon is an estimate of the economic damages from greenhouse gas emissions. It informs decision making across the federal government and also many other venues here in the US and abroad. And it does it by placing a specific value in dollar terms on reducing those emissions. So on Biden's first day in office, he signed an executive order that reinstated the interagency working group tasked with providing an update to this critical estimate of climate damages. And that executive order called for estimates to be put forward actually early in 2022, this year. So in anticipation of those updates, you know, which the National Academy of Sciences recommended, RFF has been working on this issue for several years now in collaboration with many different collaborators through our Social Cost of Carbon Initiative. And we'll be releasing our own SCC estimates soon based on the latest science and methodologies. So question, when the new final estimates are put forward by the interagency working group, what do you see as the most likely consequences on policy actions taken by the Biden administration or possibly by other decision makers, particularly if the new estimates are significantly higher than the current interim estimates of around $50 per ton, which, as work already published by RFF researchers and others, suggests it probably should be and likely will be. Any major implications of that, or is it just a matter of kind of it shows up in all of these individual regulations that we already discussed? Go ahead, Ricky.
There are two different, we're still awaiting two different reports. I mean, one is the one you mentioned, that in January of 2022, we should see the final social cost of greenhouse gas number. But the administration actually is also late in producing a report that the executive order called for getting out in September of 21, which was a report on the types of government proceedings to which the social cost of greenhouse gases should apply. The social cost of greenhouse gases is just an estimate of a damage. It's nothing specific to the regulatory process, although it's mostly been used in the regulatory process. But to what extent and how should it apply to government procurement decisions, to leasing decisions for natural resources on BLM lands, to a whole plethora of decisions that almost every agency in the government makes. And that report is now late. I mean, it will come out. I mean, I would anticipate that it will give the green light to the use of this analysis in a government-wide way, because analytically, I can't think of any argument that would justify anything more limited than that. And also anything more limited than that would seem inconsistent with the president's all of government approach to climate change. So I assume that's gonna happen, and that'll get other agencies thinking. It's already happening. I mean, the Postal Service just completed a few weeks ago a final environmental impact statement on the purchase of postal vehicles that looks at the social cost of carbon and analyzing the welfare implications of purchasing electric vehicles. In terms of the number, I assume it's going to be higher, and I assume it's going to be higher in part because following exactly the same protocol that was used to come up with the 3% discount rate that has normally been used, it has often been used in the past in this context. I mean, this is a number that was blessed by OMB Circular A4 in 2003 and was based on the average of the yields of long-term federal bonds over a long period of time. And using exactly the same formula that was used in 2003, that 3% number would now be 2%. And if that number was 2%, the social cost of carbon, instead of being around $50 a ton of carbon dioxide, would be around $125 a ton of carbon dioxide. It's 2.5 times greater. And then there are all like a slew of other issues floating around, other reasons for discounting at lower rates in the intergenerational context, new economic theory, new estimates of the damages. I mean, there's like a lot of stuff. We probably won't be able to get into that now. But that one little thing, which seems totally uncontroversial, because you know it is the very same formula that was used in 2003. It just happens that in the last 20 years, the yields on government securities have gone down a lot, and everybody knows that would raise it a lot. I guess that would make the benefits of greenhouse gas reductions greater. It would, I mean, to the extent that the Supreme Court now says that regulations should not be adopted if they do more harm than good. I mean, there'll be more good being done, so we could justify higher costs and more stringent regulations. EPA has not always taken advantage of the estimate of the benefits. I think that if one looked at the social cost of carbon in effect during the Obama administration and try to maximize the net benefits of regulation, the Clean Power Plan would have been more stringent. Basically net benefits were left on the table. And I think EPA should be more aggressive in capturing net benefits. In the proposed vehicle emission standards that were put out in the fall, net benefits were left on the table. EPA actually proposed an alternative that had lower net benefits than a more stringent alternative would have had. In the final rule, EPA actually moved closer to the alternative that it said maximized net benefits. And that was a very, very good move. So I would expect that a higher number for the social cost of greenhouse gases, which I think we will have and should have, will allow EPA and other agencies, and in both regulatory and non-regulatory contexts, to justify actions that have greater climate change benefits.
Can I ask a question, I think, or at least raise an issue about how equity is dealt with in consideration of the social cost of carbon? Because it's now quite clear that exposure to greenhouse gases and to global warming is disproportionately impacting on the poorest segment of the population. That could lead you on a blanket basis to sort of say that that's less important because by definition, there's, poorer people don't make as much money. But on the other hand, I hope that's not the way we think about these issues. And we're trying to move in the opposite direction when it comes to equity. So I don't know if anybody on this panel has any experience with how that might be put into the report or into the actual number. But clearly, there's a relationship here.
Yeah, and Mary, actually, was just going to turn the conversation more to issues around environmental justice and also equity in the energy transition. I'll just quickly say, as I've thought about and engage in conversations around the addressing of equity considerations within the social cost of carbon. I mean, the social cost of carbon by design is a quite aggregate even, you know, global metric, right? So there's a lot of different impacts that can be estimated at a very granular level, but then they're added into a quite comprehensive global number. And so I personally think it is challenging to use that one metric, which is a very important summary metric, to kind of meet all decision-making purposes. And so I tend to favor not trying to adjust the social cost of carbon to represent, you know, all equity considerations, but to use that alongside other more disaggregated measures of impact. We're actually have a major project in New York State now to do this in the context of local air pollution as that state undertakes implementation of its the Climate Leadership and Community Protection Act, which has a stipulation in it that 40% of the benefits of those actions go to disadvantaged communities, which is a great segue to my next question. So, you know, of course, environmental justice is front of mind for the Biden administration as it moves forward on climate and the broader environmental agenda. Also on Inauguration Day, Biden signed an executive order on racial equity and underserved communities and promised to deliver at least 40% of the overall benefits of federal investments in climate and clean energy to disadvantaged communities. So this has become known as what is called the Justice 40 Initiative. So Carlos, you know, you've led research and analysis across a diverse range of climate and energy issues, including environmental and energy justice. So tell us a bit about what we know so far about the specifics of the Justice 40 goal, progress on its implementation, and the main outcomes we're likely to see in 2022.
Sure. Well, what we know so far is that, I mean, in terms of legislation, certainly Build Back Better was an intentional legislation focusing on so many of the social safety net issues and integrating statutorily the intent of Justice 40. And just to be clear, Justice 40, as it's written at the federal government in the executive orders, is 40% of benefits going to underserved communities, not 40% going directly to underserved community of specific funds. And so what we've seen in the Infrastructure Act, for example, has been a much more muted attempt at incorporating anything remotely related to equity. There are certainly some positive steps, like more funding of brownfields, more funding of Superfund site remediation, that helps many of the previously what are called environmental justice communities. But so much of the work right now is going on at federal agencies, particularly on the discretionary grant program side, to incorporate Justice 40-like efforts. And so each of the agencies are charged with developing their definition of underserved communities and then figuring out how their grant programs then give those grants out. So it's very much a work in progress. The guidance came out in July 2021. The agencies are eventually rolling out their in some cases, it's much more programmed rules rather than official rulemaking around their grant programs. In one case, even I saw that, for example, FEMA's flood mitigation assistance program, the current RFP for grants is more aggressive about equity in terms of income levels and eligibility than what is statutorily included in the flood mitigation assistance program in the Infrastructure Act. So it's still very much a work in progress, the Justice 40 work. And it really depends on long-term commitments by the federal agencies. The concern, of course, is that for the administration to change what the long-term effect of this kind of funding is going to be. So something that's a little longer term in terms of appropriation that explicitly includes equity requirements and are probably going to be helpful.
So say a little bit more about that. You know, so the inclusion of a Justice 40 goal in federal processes is a new thing. And we obviously have changes in administrations every 4 years, at least, well, we have elections every 4 years. Sometimes we have a change in administration. So if there's an idea to kind of maintain that type of a policy and an element of decision-making, in a new administration after 2024, are there particular things that policymakers should be thinking about, that even could survive, you know, partisan politics in terms of how this consideration of equity currently through Justice 40 gets kind of ingrained in federal decision making?
Sure. I mean, one of the things that I find interesting in the Infrastructure Act was that so much of the equity integration of equity considerations were new studies that is focused particularly on water disparities and transit, like the Healthy Streets programs. But there are a large number of studies that are included for funding. So one would assume that by the next administration, that those studies would have been completed. There would be more evidence regarding disparities by race, by income level, and by a variety of other demographic characteristics. So there would be more evidence. So obviously, as researchers, our concern is that if there's sufficient evidence to make a case for policy change, that would at least fall on somebody's ears within either the new administration or Congress. But again, I mean, we're already dealing with one thing we haven't talked about at all in 2022 is the fact that this is a midterm election year. And so there's a lot to be said for what Congress is going to be able to do in the future with regard to statutorily integrating race and wealth disparities within legislation.
Mm-hmm. When we think about the data collection and analysis needed to inform the tools that policymakers need to successfully deliver on this goal, are we there yet? And what, you know, at a high level, are there things that remain to be done?
There definitely are. The EJ screening tool is still a work in progress in EPA, the revisions to it. I mean, certainly we've seen major advances to it. But the way that plays out, I mean, obviously every medium, environmental medium, and every program has the way that inequity has played out in those areas differs a little bit. So it's going to be really incumbent on making sure that there are rigorous standards employed. EJ screening tool as a baseline, but for each various agency to rethink what they're doing. Obviously, EJ screening tool is starting to include things like future climate exposures, not just current and past environmental actual exposures. And so it's really important to think about the variety of data needs that are going to be necessary. And I think Justice 40 and some of the pieces of the infrastructure bill, and certainly the Build Back Better bill, had that ideal of data infrastructure being built into them. But that's very much a work in progress, and that's very much at jeopardy. The only thing I want to add to that is, even though Justice 40 is a relatively new policy concept, environmental justice certainly isn't. And so much of the action and activity that has been occurring to support Justice 40 falls on all the various activists and scholars who've been pushing this work for quite some time. So it's going to play out not just at the federal government, but at the state level and the local level, because now we're seeing many states not only continue implementing their environmental justice components, for example, California, New York's very aggressive new rulemaking, as you mentioned, Richard, but also a lot of states that are interpreting Justice 40 intentions in state legislation around where they're getting their federal money as well and how they're spending it locally.
So Carlos, you alluded earlier, albeit briefly, to the Infrastructure Act, and you recently wrote an article examining the Infrastructure Act through the lens of racial equity, and I think it's fair to say found it wanting. You know, I'd encourage our audience to read your full piece, but in the short time we have, could you briefly discuss, you know, some of these potential challenges and how implementation decisions rolling out the Infrastructure Act over the next year or more can be designed to keep issues of racial equity front of mind?
Sure. Where it gets positive scores, I guess, are on the additional funding for things like Superfund sites and granite fields, things that in which historically underserved or overexposed communities have will benefit from. But the reality is, like I said, so much of the infrastructure investment goes to traditional infrastructure, which historically has severely disadvantaged communities, everything from the well-publicized case of highways going through and displacing whole communities of color and low-income communities. There are some moments, I guess, where we could talk about specific earmarks within the Infrastructure Act that go to direct geographic communities like tribal communities, indigenous communities, and or geographic areas like the Appalachians in terms of their transportation. That could be helpful for those communities, clearly. But across the board, it's just a lot more of a lot of the same. So ideally, how the federal government, as Ricky noted, how they choose to write rules and for the formula grant programs and how they include incentives for considering equity in their competitive grant programs is going to be absolutely critical to how this plays out. So the implementation issues at the state, that's where we're going to start seeing the racial equity either dealt with or put under the rug.
Thank you. We're gonna turn just in a minute to the role of the states. It's come up, throughout the conversation, but I want to dive deeper there. But before I do that, are there any other thoughts, Ricky, on the environmental justice issue or equity in the energy transition? Yeah, Ricky.
I mean, another thing that might be a work in progress, which would be good, or might be a work in not yet progress, which would be bad, is that on day one, President Biden also signed a presidential memorandum on modernizing regulatory review. And one of the things that it calls for, very important thing that it calls for, is attention to distributional questions and to the impacts on disadvantaged communities of federal regulation. This needs to be implemented in some way. What's interesting and disheartening here is that there is sort of like decent language on distribution in both the Clinton and Obama executive orders, but I think there's kind of wide agreement that that language did not move the needle at all and has not really made a difference on the regulatory front. And the best way to show that is that even though agencies typically, in EPA and other agencies typically consider alternatives, in justifying a regulation, they're pretty much required to do that under the executive order. They do that on the costs and benefits, but they don't do that on distributional consequences. So typically EPA regulations, in Democratic and Republican administrations say, pollution disproportionately affects disadvantaged communities and this regulation will reduce pollution. So this regulation is actually good on distributional consequences, which basically means that distributional consequences play no role at all. It's just sort of like window dressing. Say, we decided to do this anyway, and now we're sort of like have this boilerplate that we add. And every major regulation of the Obama administration, the Clean Power Plan, the mercury air toxic standards, the car standards, basically has that boilerplate. What should happen, and it basically is required to happen, but OIRA has never made agencies do it, and agencies have never done it, is to look at this alternatives in connection with the distributional consequences. So, this connects to something we talked about earlier. There may be an alternative that has higher net benefits, but a different alternative may have much higher benefits for disadvantaged communities. And that should start the question of which of these alternatives should be adopted. That question has not been had until now because there has been no distribution analysis of alternatives. Not because it's not required. I think a fair reading of Circular A4 actually does require it. It's because agencies have not done it and OIRA hasn't required it. This has to be part of the implementation of President Biden's modernizing regulatory review presidential memorandum. We haven't seen it yet. And I think it's enormously important because we are relying to a large extent on regulation to move the needle on climate change. And so it's not just like federal investments, which the Justice 40 initiative deals with. It's regulation, which is imposing costs on the private sector, and the question is how it imposes. So I think that's a very important piece of the administration's environmental justice approach. It has to happen. It hasn't happened yet, and I worry that that process is not moving sufficiently quickly.
Thank you for mentioning that, Ricky. I had meant to mention that earlier in response to Mary's question that came up in the context of the social cost of carbon. So it's a very, very important point. So I want to turn to now to the states more specifically, and Mary, your work with the state of California under both Republican and Democratic governors for many years. California being also, the fifth largest economy globally, that really established the state as a clean energy leader. And so, not just for federal U.S. action, but in other states and even globally. So as we look to implementation of the Infrastructure Act with the midterms looming and with what you've seen over many years, kind of the ebb and flow of state relative to federal action, What do you see some of the major state level actions being on climate for this coming year?
Well, there are states that are moving in the direction of adopting the California vehicle emission standards, either in part or wholly, which is probably the most significant move, because when you get to the point where you've got almost 50%, really 50% of the entire vehicle market being joined together in demanding stricter standards, you have the attention of the auto industry in a way that we have not really ever had in the past. And this is a huge, huge move. And it's only a beginning, I think, not only of other states deciding that they want to be part of the club, but also of moving states in the direction of then taking the next steps to facilitate the introduction of new technology vehicles and to build a bigger market. And we're seeing movement on all of those fronts. So it's not just, let's get out there and adopt tougher standards. It's also about, let's make sure that our infrastructure is encouraging those vehicles and that we are using whatever other tools that we have as states and local governments to insist on cleaner vehicles. And again, environmental justice is woven into all of these conversations, because particularly when it comes to goods movement, the communities that are most impacted by NOx, SOx, and greenhouse gases are also the same communities that are located around major rail yards and ports in the case of California and other states. And these facilities, trucking facilities, places where vehicles congregate, are having, you know, the full panoply of social and economic disbenefits for the people who live right near them. So it's really very nice synergy in the sense that we're beginning to see the ability to demand cleaner vehicles arising in many different places and almost in a contagious way, which in turn is going to help with the transition. I think we haven't used that word much in this particular conversation, but normally whenever we get into a conversation about what's happening in the world of climate, the word transition comes up, and how do we do it and how do we make it faster? We know where we need to go. The problem is we can't wait as long as the natural political process is going to take to get us there. So whenever we can find an opportunity, and states are good at doing this, to politically link movements together, we have the opportunity to go better, to go farther, faster.
Thanks for that. Another area of kind of state level action that's relevant here in the past has been around the power sector, whether it's through, you know, state level renewable portfolio standards or state level tax incentives or other state policy, comprehensive policies like clean electricity standard like policies. Do you see momentum there? And to what extent might it depend on what happens at the federal level with regard to, you know, Build Back Better? I guess also with the SEP having been set aside, do you see an interplay there? I think that, you know, over the prior 4 years, there was a lot of state level action. I think, you know, at least some, I probably would be included, interpreted part of that as being kind of incentivized by a lack of federal level action. Do you see a continued interplay there depending upon what happens with federal legislation?
Well, there's still a lack of federal action, at least for the time being. We don't see the sufficient support for even the clean energy standard, which is not as good as what it could have been. So I think that the interest of states to continue to fill that gap is just going to continue. And that seems to be the case when I see what's happening in states like New Mexico, for example. You know, they're just not they're not planning on having the federal government be the major factor in the future, but they are determined to move ahead quickly, and they're an oil and gas producing state.
If I could just hop in on that, I was going to say that I think, I mean, I'm glad you identified it. I think the power sector is essentially one of the battlegrounds, and there's a division. I mean, it's absolutely true. New Mexico is tackling this. Illinois adopted an incredibly ambitious clean energy standard for its power sector. But you have states where the battle is absolutely, you know, shifting and tilting in the opposite direction, particularly if there's unified Republican control of the governor and the legislature. And to some extent, this is happening even on the, you know, county level, where you have ordinances that are being passed to block wind projects in coal country. So, you know, that is one of the issues when you don't have national standards. You know, California was able to use its leverage in the auto sector because of, you know, kind of longstanding precedent under the Clean Air Act. But in the case, I think we're seeing, you know, kind of two different directions depending on which political party is in power for the most part. And that will have long-term implications, of course.
Yeah. And the interplay goes in both directions. So it's not just that because the federal government is not doing certain things that the states have moved in to fill the void. But once states do fill the void, it will become easier for the federal government to actually do something when the stars are aligned, because one of the arguments that is always going to be raised against federal power sector regulation is this is impossible. It's going to, like, you know, create all these dislocations. It's going to be terrible and so on. And the best response to that is not a theoretical one, but a practical one, which is, well, the following states are actually doing this stuff already, and they seem to be doing just fine. So that's a powerful response. So having, you know, states have been regarded as sort of laboratories of experimentation. I mean, just as Brandeis talked about this early in the 20th century, and they should embrace that, because someday they will show us in the very different ways they're doing that this can be done and can be done well. And that will provide a very strong argument for federal action once the stars are aligned, which could be next year, or it could be sometime after that. But there will be a time when that will be the case.
The only state that is a grid unto itself is Texas. So everywhere else, states are connected to each other, and so are their business entities. And so it's really not possible to fight, I don't think, despite what Juliet says, which I don't disagree with. I think it's perfectly true. But that's a wave of reaction against something that I think is not overcomable when it comes to cleaning up the grid and making it more reliable.
Yeah, one of the areas that in Ricky's comment about the state federal interplay on how, you know, state level action can make it kind of easier for federal level action, we haven't really focused on the private sector as a decision maker in this particular conversation, but there's certainly a lot of decisions that have been made and will be made over the next year or more on the part of the corporate sector, which, you know, seems to be increasingly moving in the direction of decarbonization, which again also can influence the federal dynamic. But I want to turn to audience questions. I mean, we've along the way touched on some of the key questions that the audience was interested in, but I've got one here. This one I think is certainly relevant for Carlos, but others welcome to chime in as well. And the question is, can you speak to the distribution of funds for the Infrastructure Act as they pertain to indigenous communities? Are there funds specifically targeted in the $1 trillion bill to supporting indigenous people? And where do the opportunities and challenges exist for in that context in 2022? Carlos, is that something that you followed?
Yes, and both Mary and I answered online that question. I think Mary rightfully noted that tribes are, for most intents and purposes, are treated like states for much of this funding. And so it's one of the areas that has actually been carved out. I would say the only racial/ethnic group that is specifically mentioned in the Infrastructure Act would be the tribal community. So there is more funding for Indian water funds, the transportation. There's a wide, in almost every segment of the Infrastructure Act, there's new funding streams or expanding of existing funding streams that haven't received their due. So the answer is very much a yes to that question.
Thank you. Any other reactions there? And I can see that you all are ahead of me in terms of monitoring the online audience chat and Q&A. Appreciate that. One question here, which I think relates to some of the regulatory conversations we've had, but this question relates to potential in 2022, not just for legislation that promotes renewables or other clean alternatives, but also restrictions on fossil fuel production in a more aggressive push to reduce emissions. You know, would failure of the Build Back Better make such moves more likely? Or does the price of the pump hamper the White House politically in taking those steps? Now, I think we've touched a bit on that along the way. One area that we haven't explicitly touched on, though, is production, fossil fuel production, as opposed to, you know, emission regulation. I don't know if, you know, Juliet, from, you know, putting on kind of your political White House congressional lens on that, do you have thoughts on that?
I mean, it's a great question, and that is one of the biggest conundrums that the Biden administration faces. It has not curtailed fossil fuel production in the way certainly either the president pledged when he was running for re-election, or, you know, in accordance with what environmental groups are demanding. And so we've seen this as a problem, a political problem in two different ways. One, obviously, the Interior Department tried to stop new leasing, but faced, pushback in court and had to go ahead with leasing. And that applies to oil and gas drilling, but it is also the administration is proceeding with coal leasing as well. And so this is absolutely an issue. And it does speak a little bit to the social cost of carbon debate that we had earlier, in the sense that one of the things that the administration is clearly trying to do is to shift the equation when making permitting decisions on fossil fuels. And so if they alter, you know, what are the costs associated with some of these decisions, whether it's a pipeline or an oil or a gas lease or a coal lease, you know, that might make it a little more defensible in court, for example, as well as in the court of public opinion, to not permit fossil fuel extraction. But this is one of the real issues that the administration has grappled with, and it's one of the areas where on one level it has potential for action, but also is both a political and a legal minefield, given what, you know, the laws of the US and how the, you know, many of the foundational laws tilt in favor of energy extraction.
Ricky, you want to jump in on this one?
Yeah, I think one of the things I would expect to see in 2022 is rationalization of the process for the leasing terms for extracting fossil fuels from federal lands. In the very last month of the Obama administration, Sally Jewell, the Secretary of the Interior, published a secretarial order that would have done a lot of that. Updated royalty rates, straighten out the process for auctions. I mean, a lot of auctions now are non-competitive. You know, vast tracts are tied up and then not exploited, but they interfere with other uses for public lands. We have auctions by application. So companies that have ongoing operations in a place then want to bid for the adjoining parcel, but no other company has an interest in that. So they end up being non-competitive bids. This is clearly not a well-designed auction process. The remediation requirements around extraction and so on. The Interior Department has started that process. I would definitely expect to see that completed. It's basically just good government. I mean, you know, the government is selling resources that belong to the American people, and it should do it in a rational way, and that has not been the case. And the Obama administration tried to rationalize the process, but it was done in the last month and undone in the first month of the Trump administration. I would expect to see those pieces be put back together in 2022.
Thank you. Another question, or actually there's a couple questions here related to carbon pricing. And one of them, says that in the fall of 2021, discussions and coverage seem to suggest that carbon pricing was potentially back in the mix for reconciliation efforts. And the question is, are there any new rumors about including carbon fee and dividend or other forms of carbon pricing into Build Back Better or other legislation? I know, Juliet, if you want to, I'm sure you have your ear to the ground on that one.
Sorry, the short answer is no, that is not. Carbon pricing remains politically impossible to achieve on Capitol Hill at this point. And, you know, it is raised as an, I mean, it's raised as an issue. It came up in the, you know, it's come up in the discussions of Build Back Better. There are, you know, a number of senators, including Senator Whitehouse of Rhode Island, Senator Schatz of Hawaii, who advocate for it and have explored the possibility with Senator Wyden of Oregon of trying to carry that out, but that seems like a extremely difficult task. So I would temper expectations that carbon pricing will see the light of the day, you know, this year. But you know, it's not, you can't rule it out altogether.
How about Mary? You have any views on the state level? Of course, you know, California has had a cap and trade system in place for a number. I don't remember exactly I haven't looked at the allowance price in the last kind of week or two, but it's certainly higher than it's been in the past. Do you want to say anything about carbon pricing at the state level, or at least from a California?
Last year, Oregon and Washington both acted, but maybe even more valuable than the allowance trading system, which is important and which is, you know, expanding to some degree other parts of the world. Sorry, the dog or the mail delivery. I think the low carbon fuel standard is the sleeper when it comes to pricing carbon, because that particular piece of state legislation, which could be and is actually being looked at as a potential replacement for the renewable fuel standard that Congress and the country have struggled with for such a long time, has created a system of very valuable credits for organizations, companies that produce zero carbon or extremely low carbon fuels, and is really incentivizing a lot of investment in that area.
Yeah, you know, Mary, you reminded me in that comment that another decision that we haven't focused in on at all, actually, in 2022, the kind of locus of authority around the renewable fuel standard switches to the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. And so when that bill was, that act was passed back in 2007, there were legislative targets for renewable fuels as part of the transportation fuel system that went through 2022. But after 2022, the EPA has to set that level. And so that's something that I assume we should be looking for soon, I would think.
I think so too.
Yeah, so keep an eye out for that. Let me see other key questions here. I haven't really followed this one, but how will the Biden executive order on workforce training on greenhouse gases impact agency efforts? Have any of you followed that issue? Carlos, do you?
Yeah, just a little bit. It hasn't changed too much. Certainly, it's more of an incentive program and a guidance program than anything. What we saw in the Infrastructure Act, of course, was that there were explicit workforce training programs that are included. Certainly not to the scale that are in Build Back Better. But for various programs, there was additional funding for workforce training. And of course, there was a minority business development agency that was included in there as well.
Another question, actually, this one is also directed at Carlos, but I think, you know, Mary or Ricky may also view on this. Regards the Transportation Department and the degree to which the Transportation Department is factoring environmental justice into its regulatory process. Has that, have you tracked that?
Yeah, so in theory, all agencies are required to consider Justice 40 because it is an presidential executive order, right? There are certain pilot programs, including a couple in Department of Transportation. Forgive me for forgetting the exact ones. There were smaller programs. But I think what's interesting right now is the rulemaking and just public hearings that Department of Transportation is doing in its traditional highway funding, for example. There is no doubt that equity is going to come out in those discussions and in guidance that the federal government is going to make for formula block programs.
Thank you. And we're
Secretary himself is
go ahead, Mary.
The Secretary of Transportation has been very open and assertive on this issue. So I can't imagine that it won't be included in the highway funding regulations.
Absolutely. We're coming to an end here, but I just want to, we have maybe a couple minutes. Anything that that hasn't come up or that's been on your mind along the way that is important to convey? Or anything?
Sure. I'll start off really quickly. We haven't talked that much about environmental hazards, disasters, and climate adaptation, which I think is going to be one of those areas that is going to be very interesting seeing play out politically on the Hill. Since many of the places in which there have been increases in climate-related hazards are Republican-controlled, and have Republican delegations in the House, so in the and Senate. So it'll be an interesting area that we need to cover.
And just to build on that, I would say it's also interesting to see clearly this is something that the Biden administration is beginning to grapple with, but does not have an overarching plan for it. So it will be fascinating. They're beginning to nominate or put folks, whether it's in the National Security Council or FEMA, specifically designated to deal with climate disasters. And certainly it's something the president talks about, but how this is actually going to shape the federal response and how it plays out on the ground will be really interesting with these different states and different players.
Exactly, Juliet. And I'll just add one more point, and that is land use. We haven't talked about land use and environment and the state's role in dictating land use. Certainly we've seen very aggressive action in places like California regarding housing. And that I think will play out and have very clear climate implications.
Yeah, and certainly one of the ways that will play out is in the context of, you know, infrastructure planning and development, but also clean energy development, which, you know, all of which has some kind of a land footprint, but can certainly vary significantly across different, types of power sources. But, well, this has been an incredibly robust discussion, but we've reached the end of the session. So I want to, bring the event to a close by thanking all of you for joining us today, and also to the audience for your thoughtful questions. The event was recorded. It can be rewatched in full at rff.org. You can also find out more about subscribing to RFF content and supporting RFF on our website. We're really pleased, as I said earlier, to kick off our 70th anniversary with today's event. I look forward to you participating in our future events throughout the year. And finally, a really deep thanks to our wonderful speakers, Juliet, Carlos, Mary, and Ricky. Thank you all, and have a really great day.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.